Welcome to the second session of today's, and congratulations, you survived there until the third day today. So, wonderful job. And here we have an honor of Dr. Mala Schuckenbach. Am I making the pronunciation right? I'm trying. Okay, and she's the director of the Goethe Institute, Thailand, for now. And I remember meeting Mala the first time. It was like maybe 2 years back, and one and a half years back. Okay, very precise. And I remember sitting down together. We was trying to sort out some of the projects planned that we had been actually planned for a while, but suddenly everything, like in many Southeast Asian countries, things that planned for maybe even 700 years. When 1 week before when it starts, it's always a lot of surprise. So that's why, that's one of the reasons that I would like to invite Dr. Mala to share with us a little bit, not only the positive side, not only the positive outcome of all the projects, but also the making of these projects that we would like to hear from you today. So maybe, please welcome Dr. Mala. And
thank you very much, Ajahn Anutai. First of all, I would like to thank the PGVIM to invite me for this talk. I was quite, you know, excited to be invited to this symposium because my background is not in music or music science at all. You know, I'm, so to say, a cultural manager. And I said, okay, what am I going to talk? And now I also use this music stand, although my notes are actually dealing with the organization of cultural events, among them some music events. And since Anutai just referred to our first encounter, I would like to start with a small memory of what happened when I was based in India and I had to organize a very big music event. Some of the challenges, maybe just to start with, we had invited the Film Orchestra Babelsberg, and we had this, I still find great idea that the Babelsberg Orchestra, the German orchestra with a long standing tradition, comes to India and plays the music not of a German composer, but of a very famous Indian composer, A.R. Rahman, who had also won the Oscars just before. So now, importing music instruments is one of our jobs when we do such big programs, and everything was set. But then suddenly there was a new rule in India that instruments which are imported into India have to have a cooling down period of 24 hours. And with this new regulation, it was actually impossible. How shall we do it within the given scope of time? So it was like a nightmare for an organizer. You know, you think, okay, all the tour, and we had even built a hall for 8,000 people for an outdoor screening and stuff like that. I was really, honestly, I was shedding tears. So, but then finally, after shedding some tears, I thought we have to just solve this. And then I talked to the tax representatives and to the officials. And I said, you all love A.R. Rahman, isn't it? How would you like it if you can join for all the concerts and you are just there once we repack the instruments and send them to the next airport? Do they also need the cooling down period then? And then they said, no, if we are all around and we can seal the boxes of the instruments, we can travel along, all fine and set. So this is just one example of the nightmares while organizing cultural programs, for example, music programs, which we as an institution sometimes have to face. But this was just referring to your introduction. Once again, thank you very much. I'm very honored to present the work of the Goethe Institute. And I think I have to give you a short background information about what the Goethe Institute actually is. And after that, I will come to the more precise projects which we do in the field of music, which I guess interests you the most. And my hope during this 1 hour which we have together is also that after describing to you, after giving some examples what we do, that we also get some inspiration from you, questions which inspire us to do it better, to do it differently, maybe if necessary. So I would like to introduce the musical work of the Goethe Institute by starting with the international work and mission of my institution, before then going deeper into the different fields at the Goethe Institute Thailand. And after an introduction about the international musical efforts of the Goethe Institute, I will present the specific features of music mediation in Thailand and some of our latest projects. And I think it is essential to inform about the Goethe Institute in general to understand how our activities in the field of music are embedded, because sometimes here in Thailand, our partner institutions or some young artists or even from the audience, they feel, okay, the Goethe Institute, language and music. But that is not the only thing. Music is one of our focus areas, but it's not the only thing. In general, the Goethe Institute is the Federal Republic of Germany's cultural institution. We operate worldwide. We have three focus areas. The main focus area actually is the promotion of the knowledge of German language. And we have, of course, the field of culture in general. And we want to promote the information and knowledge about Germany. And especially it's important for us to also convey an image of what Germany is today. So maybe just very briefly about our language policies. What is important to know here is that we are fully aware that German language is not the only language, and in many countries it's not the most important language. So this is also another area where we have to embed what we are doing into the overall picture of where we are, where we stand, where we are located. So for example, one of the slogans of our institute is that English is a must, but German is a plus, because you have to acknowledge it. Even I'm here standing today, and the only way how I can talk to you and discuss something with you afterwards is unfortunately in English. So we actually take a stand for a multilingual world actively. Maybe that is enough regarding the language, because it's not your main focus of interest. Let's come to the cultural field. What is very important here is that we always try with our programs. I'm not so sure, to be honest, whether we always achieve it. This also refers back to the talk which I just listened to before in the other room. But we try to organize a cultural dialogue on an equal footing with leading cultural stakeholders, not only in Germany, but also in our host countries. Now, this is one challenge, of course, because if we say, okay, we want to promote, for example, the knowledge of Western classical music, that means we organize some programs where we invite a speaker, a musician, a composer. He runs the show most of the time. Somehow he stands in the limelight. He or she gives a workshop, so he is in the position of conveying information, knowledge, experience to the receiving end. What I experienced during the years I work for the Goethe Institute is that some of the artists come with this perception. I'm the teacher, I come, I bring something along, I come to Thailand, for example, and I bring this to Thailand, and I hope that the students, the participants of the workshop, will take it. But then, in the end, what we realize, and this makes me always very, very happy, is that in the end, the, for example, German artist, after conducting the workshop, for example, and before going back to Germany, they say, and that is very honest and it comes from their heart, well, I received much more than what I could bring along. Because this exchange, what then happens during those events, is very, very important also for them, and it gives them a lot of inspiration. And many times they then later come back with their own ideas, and they want to reconnect with, for example, people or the institutions they have visited and they have talked to or worked with. Yeah. What is another very important parameter for us is that we hope that we can conduct our programs at eye level. I mentioned this before, but I also just raised the issue. Maybe we can come back to that in the discussion later on. Then another area, of course, is that in general we want to provide information about Germany worldwide in a variety of ways. So we have libraries and information centers, discussion forums, publications, visitor journeys, and a website in over 40 languages, which offer multifaceted insights into what's going on in Germany in the cultural field right now. Well, there is a chart, I think, about the history now. I'm not going deep into it, but what is important to know about the history of the Goethe Institute is that it really took off after the Second World War. And that was, of course, a point in time when it was very essential for Germany to reconnect with especially its neighboring countries and to try very hard to do everything possible to reconcile after the nightmare of the Second World War. So that is basically what was the initial, so to say, impulse. And it also shapes our institute, I must say, until today. Because, for example, in our relation with the German authorities, like, for example, the Foreign Ministry, or the embassy or so on. It is very important that we are not really a wing of the embassy, but that we are independent by a very special agreement which has been formed in the 1950s, so that we never have this situation that we feel, okay, we are some sort of a propaganda institute, so to say. So this has to be completely excluded after the history of Germany, and this is what is very, very important. Of course, there have been many historical and political developments worldwide which influenced the shaping of our network. The fall of the wall, for example, the expansion into Eastern Europe, and so on. Yeah, and right now we are in this situation that we have almost 160 institutes in almost 200 countries. The youngest one, by the way, is in our neighboring country in Myanmar. It was just founded in 2013 in Yangon. What is important for my institute here in Thailand, we have neighboring countries in which we do not have our own institute, so to say, like Cambodia and Laos. So the Goethe Institute Thailand is also responsible for some activities. And this is another challenge, of course, because how from Thailand, where so much is already going on, you still have to go to Cambodia and Laos and somehow build up a network with local partner institutions and so on. So it's not so easy. Well, the map shows where we are located, but this you can all look up. Now let's come to the Goethe Institute Thailand. We are actually quite an old institute. We are founded in 1960 already. I think one of the, not the oldest, but one of the oldest. And among the institutes worldwide, we are one of the biggest among the medium-sized ones. this is the institute which you see here. It's a very nice institute, a good location. It's very spacious. There is also some area where people can meet and network. And this is also what we always hope, that people not only come to the Goethe Institute because they want to visit a particular event, but that they also use it as a meeting point for their own sharing of ideas and so on. Yeah, the language, I mentioned it already, we offer language in all the speaking levels, and we have teachers training going on, and we work with schools and so on. In the cultural field, as I mentioned before, we do not only organize music events, but we have a variety of different formats, and we work in all the genres. One focus is film. We do, for example, a German film week, we have open air cinema, we have German film series, and so on. In music, this is an image of the very smart, good-looking Katona twins. They are a very good guitar duo. They are twins, as I said, and we had a full house with their concert, so we choose this image of the two guitarists. We have, for example, the Beethoven competition for young pianists and string players. We organize concert tours and various other formats, and I come back to this in more detail in my next chapter. Then in the field of fine arts, we host exhibitions. For example, we had an exhibition on design issues called New Olds. We had an exhibition on the city becoming and decaying. Also in the field of fine arts, like in music, we very much depend on good partnerships with local institutions. For example, we cannot show any of these exhibitions without the support of the Bangkok Art and Culture Center, for example. So that is very essential. Then in dance and theater, for example, upcoming is a very interesting festival called Unfolding Kafka, where we present a production from Germany, but where we also have a co-production with a Thai choreographer, Jitty Chompy, and interaction also with the other cultural institutes. And of course, this from an administrative point of view is quite a heavy project to organize. And then there is a special field which we organize from Thailand. It's called Access to Knowledge, because interest in scientific fields is very high in this region. So we have a science film festival which runs since 2005, and in which we reach 600,000 young pupils and students via these films, which get translated into more than 30 languages. And then, of course, the Information and Library Center, where we also try to integrate more digital aspects, like the online, so that people do not only have to come physically, but can also take books from us via the digital media. Then now let's come to music activities worldwide of the Goethe Institute. On this photo you see reggae musician Gentleman and the Roots of Reggae 2013 on a tour to Lagos, Kapstadt, Dakar, Abidjan and Addis Ababa. And the amazing thing was that everywhere the audience was able to sing the Gentleman songs with him. And in some cities he also had jam sessions with local musicians. So this is an example which tells us that we also have many programs worldwide where we focus on so-called lighter entertainment, so to say, where we try to bring music programs closer to the young audience, which is, of course, one of our target groups, and where we get a lot of applause from public, but also sometimes criticism from musicians, music scientists, and this is something to debate about. I mean, what should be the program, the quality, the selection, and so on. Of course, we have a music department in our head office in Munich, and this gets the support of an advisory board, and I'm very happy that one of the members is sitting here, Dieter Mack, who also is a consultant, so to say, and the different board members of this advisory board give their opinions and we try to realize their advice via our formats and projects. In general, we try to convey an up-to-date image of the diversity of music in Germany, because what we have in Germany is a multitude of formats, genres, and we try to initiate a dialogue and an exchange between artists at home and abroad. So every year a number of music projects take place with professionals, but as well with amateur and young talents, such as tours, concerts, masterclasses, workshops, and symposiums. They cover the entire spectrum of genres in German music, early and classical music, jazz, rock and pop, electronica, sound art, and contemporary classical music. Now, not in every country you can do all the projects. So, for example, here I think the number of music events which are in the classical field, so to say, are more than, for example, in Brazil, as far as I know. So this depends on the dialogue which we have with our partner institutions, because we try to react actually to what the partner institutions ask us. And we get more ideas also from the partner institutions and more requests in the field of classical music. So here, this is the focus here in Thailand. Of course, you know that Germany's reputation as a music country is based on the diversity of the actual musical life and its outstanding musical heritage. And we claim that no other country in the world has a similar amount of opera houses, symphony orchestras, colleges of music, and at the same time such a distinct popular music scene with millions of enthusiastic amateurs. And since our task is to convey an actual and realistic image of Germany, this is what we try to present. So music played since the beginning and always plays also today a major role in the cultural work of the Goethe Institute. And let's have a closer look at what we do in terms of the formats. I think here you see some of the formats listed. So since we work in a regional context, and our region here encompasses not only Southeast Asia, but we work together with the institutes in Australia and New Zealand. So this is one of the challenges again, because Aja and Anutai asked me to talk about the challenges. If you have a region like Southeast Asia, Australia, New Zealand, it's so big, and it's very heterogeneous. You have countries like Myanmar and you have countries like Australia. So how to organize a meaningful concert tour through the, in this size? It's almost impossible. So we have to find ways how to solve this, and this requires a constant dialogue and it's a quite compact planning process. So when we do concert tours, and you know that the musicians have a lack of time normally, they cannot spend 2 months touring, so we rather choose only a few cities, but then let them stay a little longer, because we do not want that they just fly in, play, fly out. It's very important for us that these formats are combined with interactive formats like workshops, for example. And some of these concert tours left a remaining impression. For example, the first tour of the Ensemble Moderne to South America, organized by the Goethe Institute in the middle of the 1980s. And we feel that it had quite a significant importance for the development of contemporary music in this area. And other guest performances also led to an exchange with local artists or even to the foundation of new ensembles. For a few years by now, the music department forces the development of formats like co-production. That is new. Also next year, our head office wants to establish a co-production fund. I'm looking forward to this, because this will give us the possibility to apply for special funds to organize co-productions. And we already have one idea in the field of theater, but maybe something in music could also happen then. A very sustainable impact can also be seen in theme-oriented music projects. which are often conceptualized in several modules and over a longer period of time. For us, it is very important to identify new presentation formats and also new formats how we can share, how we can convey content. And I personally feel that we have to be a bit more innovative in the future and to make also better but meaningful use of digital means. So this is something where we so far, I feel, have not yet found the right clue, where we are working at and where we have to improve what we are doing. Yeah, when we come to the genres, you see a spelling mistake. It's of course the Berliner Philharmoniker on the next slide, not the Philharmonica, that's on the next one, I think. Yeah, we try to integrate nearly all interesting and top class kinds of music in our work. Part of this is the classical and classical romantic repertoire. A focus is also on music composed in the 20th century, but also on the electronic and improvised music, and as I mentioned, on all the other areas, rock, pop, and so on. I already mentioned that the expansion of Goethe Institute programs in the direction of the more entertaining or light music was sometimes discussed controversially. There was a climax of this controversy in the 1960s and 1970s with regard to the question if, in the view of some people, they call it inferior music, if this is really worth spending German taxpayers' money on this. So this was quite a clash which we had in those days. But within the Goethe Institute's view, the consideration of actual music and of lighter music would be helpful to address young people in other countries. So these are mainly strategic considerations, and I'm sure that you will have something to comment on it later. But besides the strategic considerations, of course, aesthetic and cultural sociological reasons played a role to not only concern with the high cultural music in order to maintain an extended understanding of culture. In regard to this development, there is a growing amount of artists who are interested in the interface between serious and entertaining music and who find an interested audience by the means of new presentation techniques. So my question is whether the interface is something relevant, for example, to you here in this audience, or whether you find this just ignorable. Of course, we have not retreated from the field of serious music. Instead, it is important to become sensitive not to promote or initiate programs that would also have been realized by local organizers in other countries without the help of the Goethe Institute. So what I want to say here is that we should not duplicate what others already do. This is a special challenge. If you look at our network, and maybe you have noticed when we had the chart that we have many, many institutes in Europe. This also has to do with the history of the Goethe Institute after the Second World War. And since these institutes were established long time ago, they are important, but you cannot just say, okay, now we should have many more institutes in Africa, for example. On the other hand, the cultural exchange between Germany and Italy, for example, in many fields can run more and more on its own. It does not need so much the function of the Goethe Institute in between. So this is another challenge which we have to deal with. Then, of course, there are certain service offers. So following the mission to inform the German cultural life abroad, our music department developed the internet portal Music in Germany. Here we try to report in a concentrated way about genres that are especially interesting worldwide. So by now there are genre portals about new and classic music, jazz and electronic music. Furthermore, a portal for ancient music and pop. And for these portals, about 25 specialist articles which describe interesting developments in the German music world are written per year. And regular podcasts about novelties on the German pop music market and about interesting music projects abroad round up our offering. And if we have the time, we can briefly open this link. And this gives me the opportunity to introduce Maike Wagner, who is as an intern here right now. Maybe you want to say what
we hear. I think now we will listen to jazz, explicitly about of epics and myths, with the Pasasalia Jazz Ensemble in Central Asia. I think we will just start and have a short listen to it.
It starts out strictly Baroque and morphs into floating jazz. A Handel Passacaglia performed by the Munich Jazz Ensemble Passacaglia. Welcome to this edition of the Goethe Institute podcast about the Munich Jazz Ensemble Passacaglia's tour of Central Asia. The ensemble's name says it all. Passacaglia, from the Spanish pasacalle, meaning to walk down the street, harks back to traditional music of melodic variations evolving over repeating bass figures.
Yeah, this is just an appetizer for you. We want to inspire you to use the Goethe Institute's podcasts and just click on our website and use the podcast, and you will find many interesting contributions. A large share of our programs are generated by the interplay of the Goethe Institutes abroad with our local partners, such as festivals, concert halls and clubs, and supported by the expertise of the music division or music department in our head office. And other musical projects are initiated by the dialogue of this department with renowned cooperation partners in Germany. Professional musicians who live and work primarily in Germany and are interested in cooperation with the Goethe Institute can submit materials to our department at the head office. In addition, there are possibilities for direct project funding for guest performances and working stays abroad. Guest performances in Germany by professional musicians from developing and transition countries can also receive funding. Why do I also mention our head office quite many times? You know, for example, I'm now the director of the Goethe Institute Thailand, but that means I live since now almost 15 years abroad in various countries. So it is not possible for me to observe what's going on in the scene in Germany. When I go home on my holiday, of course, I go for concerts, but that is just maybe few possibilities which I have. So we need people in Germany who observe what's going on in the various fields, who have this contact to the members of the advisory board. For what? To ensure quality. Because quality is something which we always strive for in our programs. Of course, quality is a debatable, again, a debatable word. One can spend hours and hours to discuss what is quality, but nevertheless, it is important, and this is one of the issues which we always have in mind, that we have to think about it and not ignore this. Then I would like to mention that we, of course, have also in mind the young talents and the amateurs. And we feel that the scene of these young and amateur musicians in Germany is really very big in its diversity and also in quality. For example, over 8 million young and amateur musicians play or sing in a choir or an orchestra, in rock bands, jazz groups, or chamber music
ensembles. And every year, therefore, the Goethe Institute supports 300 to 400 international projects by these ensembles, which carry out concert tours and concert encounters or workshops together with their musical partners in the respective host countries. And additionally, the Goethe Institute also promotes guest performance tours to Germany. So likewise also, for example, musicians, choirs and orchestras can in this way organize concert tours or festival appearances together with their German counterparts, and this gets some support as well. Then there is the EUYO, OYO, it's a very strange name for an orchestra, but once a year the Goethe Institute conducts auditions for the German candidates for places in, and now I tell you what it is, the European Union Youth Orchestra. The European Union Youth Orchestra is the official youth orchestra of the EU, and its members are the talented young musicians from all 27 European countries between the ages of 14 and 24. I think we don't need to open this now. Yeah, of course, right now many other things are going on in Germany, and I hope that there is still a way to find together also through music projects in Europe. Now in Thailand, here in Thailand, I must say, I'm now here since 1.5 years, and I was quite surprised upon my arrival here that concerts and classic music find to a very great extent the Thai population's approval. What I want to say is that here in Thailand, I find that many more people are very, very interested in music projects than in other countries I've been to. So, for example, when I came to Mumbai, many, many artists, of course, wanted to introduce themselves, and they said, yeah, we are a painter, we are a photographer, so many other things came up immediately, whereas here it was especially music. The great enthusiasm also of the public shows that such fields can be extended in the future, and that a sufficient audience, if we organize our events well, can be achieved. The focus in regions like Thailand, where the majority of the population is not so used to listening to Western classical music, it is a task to identify useful links to initiate programs. Fortunately, there are quite a few opportunities. For example, the Goethe Institute Thailand finally developed itself as one of a place for chamber music in the country by continuous program work in this field. Our venue, our concert hall, doesn't look very nice right now, that's why we have to renovate it, but the acoustics, for example, is very good, so we quite get good comments on that. Another focus is on the promotion of the young Thai and Southeast Asian musicians, as well as the development of educational standards for musicians that are similar to those in Europe. I think whoever was just now with me in the other talk before might have second thoughts about this, and this is another point for discussion. To foster this educational emphasis, the performances of guest musicians are always integrated in varying formats like workshops, classes about classic music, or even music history. To support talented music students in Thailand, the Goethe Institute also offers concert opportunities, supported or provided by different faculties of music throughout Thailand. So what I can say is that some of the Thai musicians had their first appearance in public on our stage. And it's quite a cozy place, so it's not so challenging for them, and from there they take off sometimes. There are quite a few examples. And this is also something which I like about us, that we are a place where people dare to come to perform, even if they are not yet a high professional, but it's a it's a space where you can also try out things and then take it further from there. Yeah, to the genres, in the field of classical music, the Goethe Institute organizes competitions. This is one format which is quite popular here in Thailand. People like to compete with each other. So this was also quite strange for me, a competition, Beethoven competition. We as the Goethe Institute, we do it, but well, we do it since I think 9 years. It's also a way how one can support young musicians. We will look at the competition a little later. The Goethe Institute also cooperates with faculties of music from the country and took part in the foundation of the TPO. By the way, the Thailand Philharmonic Orchestra is just celebrating its 10th anniversary this year, and we are very happy that we could accompany the TPO on its way. Jazz also has a major importance for the Thai audience. One upcoming event is the Jazz Festival at the Mahidol University, where we participate with a quartet, which we invite from Germany, and they will also conduct workshops during the jazz camp, which is happening. The Goethe Institute joins the network of local and national music institutions, as well as universities, to initiate programs which provide an additional value, that's what we hope, not only for the audience, but also for the musicians and students. One of our important partners mentioned already is the Mahidol University. I just mentioned the TPO, and with the aim to support young musicians, for example, also to play under the guidance of a German conductor, and to give a concert in Bangkok as well as in neighboring countries. We also have a cooperation with the Silapakorn University, where we invite German musicians to organize concerts or to organize workshops with a focus on wind instruments. And of course, last but not least, we have a very productive partnership with the PGVIM, which for example led to the working stay of Christoph Poppen, the conductor Christoph Poppen from Germany in Thailand, during which he gave class to young students and performed a concert together with them. And I'm always happy to be here. I wish I could come much more often. Yeah, I already mentioned the Beethoven Festival. So this is one of the specific projects that which we implement since quite a few years. Then when Maestro Poppen came for the first time, he also conducted the Thailand Philharmonic Orchestra's New Year's concert. This is of course a format where you reach a big audience because the event on New Year is quite significant. And it has been a signature event, so to say. Of course, this is, I think, a chart of the PGVIM event, which I just mentioned, where Christoph Poppen conducted the PGVIM Youth Orchestra. And now I come to two projects which personally I found very, very rewarding, but nevertheless, unfortunately, they have not been taken forward. The first project is the Southeast Asian Youth Chamber Orchestra. As far as I know, I was not here at that time. The idea came up in 2011 or 2012 to establish a Southeast Asian Youth Orchestra. It was an initiative of the Mahidol University with the support from the Goethe Institute, but the project had to rely on very heavy sponsorship. So the financial aspect, of course, plays a big role for us as a cultural institution. How do we fund all these programs? So in 2014, the Goethe Institute decided to not follow up on the project any further, as it would exceed the scope of a project, because a project in our understanding officially is it has to have a beginning, it has to have an end. But if you are a founding partner of an orchestra, how do you withdraw from it? So here is a very critical thing, because I feel that, for example, supporting the foundation of an Asian Youth Chamber Orchestra, so much could develop from it, and I would actually like my institution to be part of this path. But then, of course, there is the other issue, the other strategical thoughts. How do we go forward with this if it takes on for 10, 15, 20 years? So I must say, here in this project, the Goethe Institute reached its limit, and the sad reaction was that the Goethe Institute withdraw from it, and now, as far as I know, the future of this orchestra is not quite clear. What's going to happen, whether somebody else is going to take it up. So this is a sad story, and sad stories also happen. Another one is the Young Composers Competition, and I think Dieter can also, as we say in German, ein Lied davon singen, sing a song about it. The Young Composers Competition first took place in Kuala Lumpur in 2009, then in Bandung 2 years later, and finally in Bangkok in 2013. It was the first project after my arrival from Mumbai, and I liked it a lot. I met many interesting persons. Basically, it's a very, very interesting program. The competition where I was at, I think there were 10 composers which were finally selected by a jury. They were from 5 Southeast Asian countries, and then meeting in Bangkok for workshops, discussions, and lectures. And the ensemble Mosaic from Berlin was there to perform the compositions of the winners of this competition. It was very interactive, and also a way how to approach new music in this region. So I found it very rewarding, fruitful, and thought-provoking. But in September 2014, the Goethe Institute ceased the funding for the competition, so no fourth edition took place, according to my knowledge, at least. And in my eyes, as I say again, this is a very sad situation. How to explain this? The Goethe Institute works in regional cooperation. As I said, we are a very, very big region. There are conflicting interests sometimes. Some people find this project interesting, some others find the other one. So finally, among the regional discussion, this project was not among those which were further prioritized. And again, this debate came up that can the Goethe Institute engage itself in continuous initiatives which have a repetitive format, like a competition which takes place every 2 years? That was one of the critical points. So these formats stand in a competition with stand-alone projects which have a clear beginning and a clear end. Then one other format is the German Winds Festival. As I said, we invite musicians from Germany who conduct workshops, but then they also perform together with the participants of the workshop. The Beethoven Festival was already mentioned, and most of you have heard of it. Here comes the spelling mistake, which I discovered last night, the Philharmonica. Yeah, I mentioned before that I'm actually interested to explore the possibilities of digital formats, although, of course, I like very much to be in a concert and see the musicians on stage. But maybe in addition to that, new digital formats can also offer new perspective. So the Goethe Institute has arranged for the license to screen digital concerts of the Berliner Philharmonica in Bangkok. But so far, another challenge, I must say, it has not been very successful. One reason is that the format is still unusual. You need very specific technical requirements to have the right quality for such a digital screening of a concert. So far, as I know, the Mahidon has these technical facilities ready, but of course the Mahidon is very far from Bangkok, and why should one travel on a Saturday evening to Mahidon, be in the traffic, and just to listen to a digital concert? So here we have not yet solved the possibility. Now my very final point is what we are doing next. What we are doing next is now that we want to explore very new formats of presenting music, and we call it anders hören. So if I translate it literally, it means to hear differently, to hear things in a different way. So we want to enable new possibilities to hear and listen by the means of communicating. For example, one idea is to conduct a concert in the dark. In Germany, we already have quite a few of these possibilities, and there is quite a few things happen in very new formats, like conducting concerts in unusual spaces, conducting concerts where the audience not only sits in front very passively and listens, but where they sometimes have a seat in the orchestra and have this listening experience from within the orchestra. So there is right now this new idea, what can the Goethe Institute do in this respect, and we will try out certain things. I feel there are a few which are maybe less challenging and to hear in the dark, but also this format to listen to the same piece twice and have a discussion in between, and then the second listening experience might be different because during the discussion you might have been informed about something to listen at in particular, but I think that is not so very brand new. Yeah, so these unusual concert situations will somehow be considered in the near future. This is the next challenge. So that's it for today from my side. Thank you very much. I hope I haven't overstretched my time.
Thank you. Thank you very much. We precisely have 2 minutes, so thank you. You're definitely 2 minutes for sharing questions. I'm sure many of you might already be working somehow with Goethe Institute, either in Thailand or somewhere else. And PGWM is one of the institutions that has been having a privilege of being a partner with Goethe Institute in many projects like Christoph Poffen, and we still actually, for this project, we still continue to work, for example, like at this time. We have the head of the jury of the Goethe International Composition Competition, and Dieter is still with us today. So we would like to also, like the youth orchestra is still continue, so we're trying to, even without sometimes lack of, how do you call it, even with this continuity of helping, but we're still looking forward to maybe also help you back in some part as well. Yeah. So any comments from, yeah, Sun Kim?
May I ask how many years you are working in Bangkok?
Since 1.5 years now. Almost 2 now. In November it will be 2.
Okay. So from since you are working here in Bangkok, so as far as I know, there is a young musicians competition by the Goethe Institute. So how you think the classical music potential in Thailand as a for the future? Just I'm very curious about it.
Well, as I said in the beginning, I'm actually not the person to judge, you know, the musical quality, because my background is completely different. But what I learn from participants and from the faculties especially is that these projects are very rewarding, because the students come out from their usual area at the university. They come to a completely different space and they meet students from other universities, and this inspires them. It also challenges them, and this is something which also enhances their development in the field. So this is what I basically learn from the faculties, because I myself wouldn't judge the musical quality or the potential, because as I said, my background is really different. But I think that from my personal listening experience, and 1.5 years is not enough time to really see a development, but also from my talks with my predecessor, who had a background in musical education, and I shared this with him, I think there is a great potential and also development to be seen, yes.
That's a very practical question. I think many of us are music teachers in different countries. So if we have a student who is interesting to make a competition or a masterclass in Germany, is there any possibility of the local Goethe Institute to support this with money or with connection or so? Is this something
there are some
you can
there
do?
Are some project schemes, and one has to look at the individual case and then to see which of the schemes which we have in place could apply to that. So in general, we are very open for such proposals, and we also organize such trips. And for example, during the Beethoven competition, what is very important that the winners after after the competition, the winners go to Bonn, and they then perform at the Beethoven Festival in Bonn. So this is, for example, one way where we also send young Thai artists or talents, musicians, to Germany. There are schemes, and one has to look at the specific request or idea. Yeah.
We will come to you.
Yeah, okay. Sure.
May I just add to that point, there's also the German Academic Exchange Service, DAAD, and there are a lot of new programs of music exchange things also for that, what you are interested in. So it's not only the Goethe Institute, there's also a branch of the DAAD in your office, as far as I remember, and they should also know about music exchange programs, which are quite new. So we can send ensembles from Germany to here and ensembles from here to Germany, and that will be supported by the German Academic Exchange Service. So this is something which is really, which really became more fluent and more widespread in Germany at the moment. Even there are some foundations, but I don't know so much about the foundations. Just to add to that, yeah.
Okay, so I think we can still continue. Dr. Mala will still be with us. Mm-hmm. Okay, so so just to keep the time going, maybe we can continue this discussion with Dr. Mala after this. So thank you very, very much, and thank you very much.